Good morning. Hope you're all rested after your free afternoon yesterday. So I'm happy to introduce someone who, particularly at IMPA, needs no introduction. Fernando Coda Marquez from Princeton is going to tell us, it's the first of two related lectures, going to tell us about Minimax theory.
Okay. Thank you, Steve. So thank you very much to the organizers for the invitation, especially Harold and Misha. So of course, this is a very special place for me. So it's really nice to be here in this conference. So thank you for inviting me. Right, so this is going to be a survey talk on the Minimax theory for the area functional. Is it better now? Okay, is it better now? Okay. Right, so this is going to be a survey talk on the Minimax theory for the area functional. You know, it's a basic principle in Morse theory and in Lucerne-Schneerman theory that the topology of the underlying space is intimately related to the structure of the set of critical points of functions defined on that space. And of course, minimal surfaces are critical points for the area functional. So one should expect that this basic principle will extend to this infinite dimensional setting. So that's what we are interested in at this moment. So we are trying to get a better understanding of the most theoretic properties of the space of minimal surfaces in a given compact Riemannian manifold. So there's a lot that it's already known, but there are also some fundamental missing ingredients. So I'll try to summarize a little bit of that story here. And then in the second part of, in the second talk, my collaborator Andre Neves is going to prove some specific results that we have jointly. Okay? So we've seen this word already a few times here, Minimax, in this conference. So the Minimax technique is a technique to find critical points of functions by exploiting a non-trivial topology of the underlying space. So we can illustrate this technique with this very simple example. You need some space, Z, with some non-trivial topology. You have some function f. And then, for instance, you can detect this critical point C1 here. This is a critical point of f with index equal to 1. It has some critical value here. So it turns out that you can detect this guy here by looking at loops that go into the hole of the surface. Maybe I should use some color here. So you have this non-trivial topology here, so you can consider these non-trivial loops. And then you can just see that the critical value associated to this critical point of index 1 will be the Minimax value of, if you just look at the, take first the soup of the height function over such loops, and then you minimize this over the class of non-trivial loops, right? So the topology here is implying that there must be a critical point of index 1. So you can see also that in this particular example, the index matches the number of parameters. You're doing min and max over a one parameter family. So that's what you should expect that in general should be true. So that's the basic idea, right? So you need a space with non-trivial topology. So I think that the first time this technique was used in geometry was in the work of Birkhoff, maybe 1917. So Birkhoff proved that every Riemannian metric on a two-dimensional sphere admits a smooth closed geodesic. So the idea is that you have some two-dimensional sphere with some Riemannian metric, some geometry, then I can look at, say, a degree one maps from S2 to itself, then I can look at the image of the standard foliation of S2 by level sets of this height function, right? So I can look at the image of this thing. Maybe it is something like that. So I have this gamma of t here, which is just the image under phi of the, say, the set of points where x3 equals 2t minus 1. So I guess this goes from t, goes from 0 to 1. So this is the loop that is going into the hole of the space of closed curves. Right? So it's a non-trivial one-parameter family of closed curves, starting and ending at the trivial point curve. So these are called sweepouts. So the space of closed curves has this non-trivial topology, and once you have non-trivial topology, you can run the min-max process for the length function, right? And then you produce a smooth closed geodesic. So there is smooth closed geodesic. This actually answered a question of Poincaré. All right. So then the next important result, this theorem is due to Lusternik-Schneerman, who basically, this is maybe around 1929, I guess, who basically realized that you can do better, right? Because they noticed that the sweepouts considered by Birkhoff are modeled on this one-parameter family of closed curves, but given by round circles, right? But the space of round circles is much bigger. One can actually parameterize the space of round circles by RP3. So you get a whole RP3 family of closed curves. For instance, you can take this parameterization, let's see, lambda RP3 to the space of, let's say, unoriented round circles in S2. So this is just the map picks a point with projective coordinates A0, A1, A2, A3, and sends this into the set of points in S2 such that A0 plus A1 x1 plus A2 x2 plus A3 x3 is equal to 0. So of course this defines a round circle in S2. So notice that this is well defined because if I multiply this list of numbers by minus 1, maybe the orientation of the circle I'm getting here will change, but I'm considering unoriented round circles, so this is fine. So you get a whole RP3 family of closed curves in S2 that you can vary by, again, taking images under degree one maps. So you get non-trivial homotopy classes here. So in fact, every RP3, of course, contains non-trivial RP2, which by itself contains a non-trivial RP1. And then by performing mean max over these three families, you get three mean max lengths. And then basically you prove what it's called the three closed geodesics theorem, that there's always, so the theorem of Lusternik-Schneerman is that there are always at least three smooth closed geodesics in any Riemannian sphere. You can even argue that these curves are embedded. So 3 is the optimal value because of some ellipsoidal examples. But if you allow immersed closure desics, it's actually true that any Riemannian two-sphere contains infinitely many immersed closure desics. So this follows from the works of Franks and Bengert. By combining both works, I guess in the 90s, there's always infinitely many. Smooth closure desics. Of course, now they can intersect themselves. Right, so I'm not going to mention much more about this, but let me just point out that there's, as far as I know, there's no completely variational proof of this particular result. So we are interested in higher dimensions. Right? So we would like to you give me a compact Riemannian manifold. So the basic questions are, is there a minimal hypersurface, say? If so, how many of those? And then maybe which properties these minimal hypersurfaces have. So we'd like to have some statement that would be robust enough to that it applies to interesting classes of Riemannian metrics. So the first person to consider this problem was Almgren in the 60s. You know, the idea is to produce these non-trivial minimal varieties by topological methods. So you need a space with non-trivial topology, right? So the first question you ask is which space we're going to look at. So there are several possibilities. Maybe you want to work with parametrized objects. Well, Almgren decided to look at geometric measure theory. So the geometric measure theory will give you embedded minimal objects. So what he did is was he looked at the space of the natural space to look at from the point of view of geometric measure theory. Is the space of integral cycles. So let me introduce a notation here. So I'm going to denote by ZL of M n plus 1 with Z coefficients here. This is the space of L dimensional integral currents with zero boundary. So to be short, we say integral cycles. Right. So one should think of an element of this space as a linear combination of Lipschitz submanifolds with that have no boundary with integer coefficients. That's like the typical element would look like. So. But it can also, it turns out that for some applications, and that's the case of the application that Andre is going to explain in the next talk, it turns out that it's also important to look at the space of submanifolds with coefficients in Z2. So that's the space of L-dimensional flat cycles modulo 2. No. Again, a typical element will be some linear combination of submanifolds with no boundary, where these coefficients here are either in Z or Z2. So that's the space one would like to look at. Of course, I have to say what the topology is. So the most natural topology is called the flat topology. That's the topology as originally considered by Whitney. So the idea, you know, this is given by some metric, T1 and T2. But the idea is that you should think of T1 and T2 as being very close to each other in the flat topology if you can find, say this is T1, this is T2, if you can find a, let's say, an L plus 1 chain U such that, you know, the boundary of U is T2 minus T1, entity 2 has a small area. Okay? So the area is called the mass. Mass functional. It's just given by. If you look at this particular example, the mass of that guy is going to be just the sum of the areas with the proper multiplicities. Of course, here I have to take the L-dimensional area. Right? Yeah. So basically, the flat topology is sort of measuring the k plus one, the L plus one area of this sort of chain here. Okay. So you have a natural space to look at. You have a natural topology and a natural functional. So that's the setting that Almgren considered. So in particular, one can try to compute the homotopy groups of that space. So that's what he did in his thesis. So he proved a very nice result. This is called the Almgren's isomorphism theory. So he proved that if I look at the k-dimensional homotopy group of the space of cycles, of space of L-dimensional cycles, let's say based at the zero current. I haven't said here, but m n plus 1 is just a compact, say, Riemannian manifold of dimension n plus 1. So he proved that the k-dimensional homotopy group of the space of L-dimensional cycles is isomorphic to the k plus L dimensional homology of the underlying space of the manifold with integer coefficients. And that the isomorphism here is canonical. That's his theorem. So this is true also for Z2 coefficients. If you take pi k ZL. If you look at modulo 2 flat cycles, again, you're going to get an isomorphism with the k plus L dimensional homology with Z2 coefficients. So let me maybe give you a quick idea of what the isomorphism is. So the idea is relatively simple. So maybe let me explain the case of one parameter sweepouts. So you imagine that you have, let's say I'm looking at pi 1, so I have a map phi from the interval 0, 1 to the space of hypersurfaces. Let's say the map is continuous in the flat topology. So I can subdivide this interval many, many times so that two consecutive hypersurfaces here, or not hypersurfaces, but two consecutive cycles here will be very close to each other in the flat topology. If you look at the picture here, this is the manifold. Say this is ti minus 1, and this is ti. So I get phi of ti minus 1. Here I get phi of ti. So if the subdivision is sufficiently fine, there will be an L plus 1 chain ui with small mass, such that the boundary of ui is just the difference between phi of ti. Okay. So if you sum all of these guys, you see that, because this is there will be a telescopic sum here, the boundary of the sum is equal to zero. Right? So that's the sum of these chains is actually an L plus one cycle. So it's naturally an element. This is naturally an element of the homology group. This case would be the L plus one homology group of the manifold. So that's the isomorphism. This guy would be lambda of, you know, lambda of my map phi. And you can repeat the process for a larger number of parameters. Let me just mention that in the case of a square. So if you have now a map from the square, let's say phi again, each point here is being sent into some cycle, some L-dimensional cycle. Say that the boundary of the squares of this square is being sent into the zero current. Again, you can subdivide this efficiently many times, so that two adjacent cycles, again, will be very close to each other. So you can find, again, between for each edge here, right, you can find an L plus 1 dimensional chain such that its boundary is the difference between the two cycles. But now if you sum this chain over the edges of a little square here, you get a cycle, right? An L plus 1 cycle with very small mass. So again, because it's a cycle, the sum of this L plus 1 guys here will be, again, the boundary of an L plus 2 chain with small mass. Right. But now if I sum all these guys, you can see that the boundary of this element is going to be 0. So again, this is naturally an element of the L plus 2 homology. So these are, you see that the isomorphisms are a sort of canonical. And then there is some non-trivial work, of course, to prove that they are really isomorphisms. But that's the idea. OK, so now we have the spaces, we have the topology, the functional, and we know how to compute the homotope groups. So let me now mention what the Elmgren-Pitts mimics theory is about. So the idea is that you're going to consider maps phi. You fix some topological space X. And then you fix a map from X into my space of cycles. Here one can use either Z or Z2 coefficients. So this is a continuous map. Then I can consider the homotope class of this map. Now, in some applications, maybe this topological space has some boundary that you want to be fixed. So you can also talk about relative homotopy classes. But once you have some homotopy class, you can define the min-max value for the area function that's called the width. The usual way, this is just the infimum of the supremum of the masses. So you look at all maps phi prime in the homotope class. For each such map, you take the sup of the masses. So that's the width. And then the theorem is the following. So far, I'm talking about general L-dimensional objects, right? Later, I'm going to restrict to hypersurfaces. So in this setting, the theorem is the following. It says that if the homotope class is non-trivial, and this can be measured by whether this number is zero or not, then there exists some minimal variety, let's say L-dimensional variety, V. So by that, I mean, for those who are familiar with geometric measure theory, I mean a stationary integral variable. So these are geometric configurations that are critical for the area functional. They are smooth almost everywhere, but they could come with singularities. For example, just take the union of two planes. That would be an example of a stationary integral variable. You can always find a minimal variety V such that the mass of V is equal to the width. Okay, so this is the theorem. That's the most general statement. Now, if I restrict to the codimension one case, so in the codimension one case, so this means that I will take L to be N, and here that I have to consider that N is greater than or equal to 2 to avoid talking about one-dimensional stationary variables. So in the codimension one case, actually one can take V to be of the form linear combination like this, where sigma i's are they are smooth, embedded, minimal hypersurfaces, perhaps modulo singular set of codimension 7. And here this n i's here are positive integer numbers. And these guys are, this is a disjoint collection. Okay, so that's the theorem for the case of hypersurfaces. Of course, if the ambient dimension is less than or equal to 7, you get perfectly nice, smooth, embedded, minimal hypersurfaces. So that's the theorem. So the contributions here was the first part where one considers general cycles is due to Almgren. So Almgren couldn't succeed in proving that that there is a smooth guy. So it's actually an open question whether one can prove that there are smooth minimal submanifolds in general in a given compact Riemannian manifold. But then Pitts came up with this notion of almost minimizing variable, and he was able to prove the regularity in the codimension one case. In high dimensions, actually, there's also a contribution by Shen and Simon to get a singular set of codimension sevens. So that's what Almgren-Pitts MIMX theory is about. But of course, in order to make it useful, one needs a non-trivial families, right? So that's where the Almgren's isomorphism theorem comes in. Maybe I at this point, I guess I'm going a little bit slow. At this point, I should start talking about some interesting families. So if you look at, we're fixing some compact n plus one dimensional Riemannian manifold. Let's say we are talking about the codimension one case, so taking L to be n. And now suppose that I look at the fundamental group, the pi 1 of the space of hypersurfaces. Here I will take Z2 coefficients. So by Almgren's isomorphism theory, this is isomorphic to the n plus 1 dimensional homology of M with coefficients Z2. And of course, M is compact, this is Z2, so Almgren's theorem is telling us that the fundamental group of this space is non-trivial. So we have a family, non-trivial family there. So it turns out that one can very easily write a generator for this fundamental group. The idea is that you consider most functions You take your favorite most function f, here's 0 to 1, and then you just look at the level sets of f. So phi of t is just the level set corresponding to t. So these are perfectly good cycles from the point of view of geometric measure theory. And it's also easy to see that this is going to be a generator, right? Because if you look at the isomorphism theorem, you see that the corresponding cycle will be the fundamental cycle of the manifold. So every most function gives you a generator of that. So if you start with two very different most functions, maybe the sweepouts are very different from each other, but they are homotopic in this general theory, in the point of view of geometric measure theory. So once you have a non-trivial family, you can apply the Mimex theorem. And one corollary of that, so the corollary, this was the main application of the Amgren-Pitts Mimex theory back then, is that if you are, let's say, if the dimension, if the ambient dimension is in between 3 and 7, then M contains a smooth embedded minimal hypersurface. So there is always at least one. That was the theorem. Okay, so this is for the case of hypersurfaces. But notice that if you look at the space of L-dimensional cycles, you can do something similar. So let's say that I look at the space of L-dimensional cycles here. Let's take coefficients in Z2. So here, I guess, I can look at the following homotopy group. I guess I will take the n plus 1 minus L homotopy group of this space. So that, again, by Amgren's theorem, this is going to be Z2. So this space also is non-trivial. So the corollary is that every mn plus 1 g contains a minimal variety. I said that it's open whether you can prove that there is a smooth guy. It's also relatively easy to visualize these families, right? Because you can think about this one parameter sweep out as just, you can embed this manifold in some, say, high-dimensional Euclidean space, and then you can think that you're picking some height function, and then you're slicing your manifold by hyperplanes in that big Euclidean space. But now I can choose a different transversal sort of height function also, and then I get a two-parameter family of hyperplanes. Right? So these guys will intersect my manifold in a codimension 2 guy. So this way you can visualize what these non-trivial families look like by these slices. Okay, so that's the Amgren-Pitts Mimex theory. Let me mention now that there are some alternatives. There's one alternative, a variant of this theory that has been mentioned here in this conference. Maybe let me mention make some comments here. It's a variant due to Simon and Smith. So the idea is that this Amgren-Pitts theory is very nice because it's very general. So we will see that in many applications that we have been able to find, the families tend to be continuous only in the flat topology. So it's nice to have such a general theory. But in some other situations, you would like to control, for instance, the topology of the minimal surface that you are producing. So you'd like your sweepouts to be better controlled. So you can do that by looking at sweepouts, which basically look like level sets of mass functions, but then instead of varying them in the flat topology, you consider only variations by isotopes. So this has been mentioned here. So in particular, Simon and Smith were able to prove this is a variant you vary by isotopes. So they were able to prove that every, for instance, every three-dimensional Riemannian sphere contains an embedded minimal S2. Because you can consider sweepouts of S3 by spheres, and then you can control the genus of the surface that you get in the end. So there's a nice survey paper by Codin and Delalis where they explain this alternative. Also suggest looking at the papers of Pitts and Rubinstein, who made several applications of these sweep outs to three manifold topology. So the point is that one can control the genus of the surfaces. So there has been progress very recently on the issue of the genus of the minimal surface. So actually the optimal genus bounds were recently obtained by Cadover as conjecture by Pitts and Rubinstein. Although the problem about the index I'll mention in the end of my talk still remains open. Right, so let me also mention that I guess Lohamaze talked about this construction of minimal surfaces in non-compact hyperbolic Riemannian manifolds. So let me mention that another recent result in the direction of producing minimal surfaces in non-compact manifolds is due to Montezuma, who is a PhD student of mine, where he sort of developed a kind of modified Mimex theory for intersecting slices. The idea is that if your manifold happens to have a concave open set, and if your manifold is not too thin at infinity, then one can take the traditional sweepouts, but look at the area of only of those that intersect the concave set. So by doing that, one is able to obtain minimal surfaces, at least for some classes of non-compact Riemannian manifolds. And finally, this is the last remark, this part of the talk. I also mentioned that one expects that it should be true that every, so question here is whether every metric in S3 contains four embedded. By analogy with Lusternik-Schneerman result, minimal spheres. So there's an approach here by Yost. But we have to say that the arguments are a little bit subtle, so we cannot really understand fully the proof. So it would be better to have a cleaner argument for that. One of the problems being that in this theory, the surfaces can come with multiplicity. So it's hard to argue that the surfaces you're producing are different from each other. Okay, so at this point until now, I have been talking about situations in which first one starts from the non-trivial topology of the space of cycles, and then one produces a minimal surface out of that. But it turns out that it can be very interesting to do the reverse process. You have a nice minimal surface that you know very well, and then you ask the question, how can I produce it by Mimax? So what is the family that will be able to give me this minimal surface by a Mimax method? So we looked at this question and together with Andre Nevis, and we sort of discovered this new multi-parameter sweep outs that I'd like to mention very briefly here. So in connection with the Wilmer problem, so of course, if you look at S3 with the round metric, there are some, you know, we know infinitely many examples of minimal surfaces here, but there are two of them which are very nice, very simple to describe. Of course, the first is the equator. The simplest one is the equator. Say this is just the, say x4 equals 0. This is the equator. This is a minimal surface with index 1. Here it is. And this is the surface that you get if you apply Almgren-Pitt's Mimex theory or Simon-Smith version for the generator of pi 1. That's the surface that you get, the equator. But you also have this very nice surface called the Clifford torus. In S3, this is also minimal. It turns out that the Clifford torus has index 5. So we pose ourselves the question, how can we, is it possible to produce it by Mimex by finding some kind of non-trivial family? So we discovered that the answer is yes. So what the family looks like is, how do you get the family? So what you do is, first you look at conformal transformations. Notice that the index is 5, so you need at least five parameters to be able to construct it. So very roughly, the idea is that one can parameterize, you know, this is S3, this is the boundary of B4. So for every vector V in the four ball, we can associate a conformal transformation of the boundary itself, which basically looks like a dilation fixing V divided by normal V and minus V divided by normal V. So the geometry, they would do something like this. If you do stereographic projection with respect to that axis, these are just standard dilations of Euclidean space, right? So as the vector V goes to the north pole here, these transformations send sort of like everything to the south pole except the north pole itself. So once you have these conformal transformations, what you can do is that you can define this family sigma hat of VT to be just the set of points in S3 such that the distance from X to the image of sigma hat under this conformal transformation is equal to T. So you apply these conformal transformations. This will give you a four parameter family of surfaces, but then you take the equidistant ones, and that corresponds to the fifth parameter here. So V is in the four ball. T goes from minus pi to pi. So it turns out that if you do that to the Clifford torus, after a reparametrization, you get the following behavior. So the family is defined in the solid cylinder. This is B4 times minus pi to pi. So the surfaces are trivial at the top and also at the bottom. Maybe for some point x inside here, we have a surface sigma of x, which might have some genus. Maybe the genus even increases because the equidistant deformation is not a smooth one. Right. So you don't control the topology of the surfaces. But once you go to the boundary of the parameter space, you can look at this vertical line here. So the corresponding surfaces will be round spheres. That's the boundary behavior. And these round spheres are centered at some point Q of V. And then in this particular case, because we are applying this process to the Clifford torus, one can check that the degree of this map as a map from S3 to itself is equal to 1. So in general, if you apply to a surface of genus G, you get that the degree is equal to G. So we prove that because of by using the fact that this degree, that this center map has non-trivial degree, we prove that this family cannot be deformed. So that area decreases. So the sup of the areas is achieved by the Clifford torus. There is somewhere inside here, 2 pi squared, that's the sup of the areas, but there's no way to deform it so that the area is decreasing, right? So this was the sort of the key element in our work on the Wilmer conjecture. So somehow we are detecting a new kind of hole, right, in the space of surfaces in S3. This five-dimensional sort of hole there, produced by the Clifford torus. So given that there are some topologists here in this audience, maybe let me just mention very briefly that we are able to give an application of this theory to a problem about links. So the point is that the problem is the following. You start with a two-component supposed to be disjoint. Two-component link in R3, and then you can define this energy associated to this link. This is the integral of gamma 1 prime S or gamma 2 prime of T divided by the distance square. This is called the Möbius energy of the link, and it happens to be conformally invariant. So the conjecture was that this was due to Friedman, Hay, and Wang, 94. The conjecture was that the energy of any non-trivial link must be at least 2 pi square. If gamma 1, gamma 2 is non-trivial. So we proved jointly with Eagle and Nevis that this is true. And basically the idea is that you can reduce this problem to two-component links with linking number equal to plus or minus 1. And then once you have such link, because the energy is conformally invariant, you can suppose these links are in S3. So let me just draw a picture here. This is S3. You can suppose now that I see my link by stereographic projection inside S3. And then once I do that, I can consider the Gauss map associated to the two-component link. The Gauss map is a map from the torus to the three-dimensional sphere. Just look at gamma 1 of S minus gamma 2 of T divided by the norm. So this is a parametrized torus in S3, and I can interpret this image here as a cycle in the sense of geometric measure theory. The key ingredient here was that the area, one can prove that the area of this image of this torus is bounded from above by the Möbius energy. So by playing with conformal transformations and considering the Gauss maps of these conformal transformations, we constructed a family of surfaces which is kind of like homotopic to that one. And then by the theory, there must be a surface there with area greater than or equal to the area of the Clifford torus, which is 2 pi squared. Therefore, the statement follows. So the way the linking number enters here is because if the linking number plus or minus 1. When you construct this family, you see that the degree of the center map is going to be equal to plus or minus 1, so that the theory applies. Okay, so these were the new families that we found in S3. So in this final 10 minutes, I would like to go back to the question of understanding more generally the space of minimal hypersurfaces. So we look at the setting again of the compact Riemannian manifold. And then we've seen that pi 1 of the space of hypersurfaces with coefficients in Z2 is equal to Z2, because that's the top homology. But then if I look at the high-dimensional homotope groups of this space, I get 0, right? If k is greater than or equal to 2, I get 0 because I'm getting some higher dimensional homology, which must be trivial there. So at first sight, this could be bad news, because this is telling us that there are no non-trivial families parametrized by spheres, by high dimensional spheres. But if you think a little bit better about this situation here, you see that there's a space with precisely those homotope groups, and that's RP infinity. So the space of hypersurfaces with coefficient Z2 has this RP infinity structure. And one can see it very precisely by defining a map from RP infinity to this space. So the idea is that you choose your favorite most function f from 0 to 1. You have the level sets of f. Then you can define the following map lambda. Let's say lambda RPK to the space of hypersurfaces. Just by considering, if you give me a point with projective coordinates A0 to AK, I look at the set of points in the manifold where I look at the polynomial of degree k with this as the list of coefficients. So I get a0 plus a1 f of x plus, so 1 plus ak f of x to the power k is equal to 0. So this is a hypersurface. Basically what I'm doing is that I have this polynomial, so this polynomial will have some roots. This hypersurface is just the union of the level sets of corresponding to those roots, counted with multiplicity, and coefficient Z2. And again, if I multiply these numbers by minus 1, I get the same object, maybe with different orientation. But again, because I'm using Z2 coefficients, this is well defined. So these families have been sort of studied before by Gromov and also Guth. And by using those, we are able to prove the following theorem. This is joint work with Nevis. This is based on Lucenberg-Schneerman theory, just like in the theorem about the three closed geodesics. So we are able to prove that, say, the dimension is in between 3 and 7. Then if the Ricci curvature is strictly positive, then M contains infinitely many smooth embedded minimal hypersurfaces. So this is the theorem that Andrei is going to prove in the next talk by exploiting this topological structure given by this RP infinity weak homotopy equivalence. So maybe let me make some remarks, and then I'll finish with some open questions, a few open questions. So some remarks about this theorem. First, this is also true, although it's not in the first version of our paper. This is also true if n plus 1 is greater than or equal to 8, if you allow codimension 7 singularities. Okay, so the key point of in this argument here is that because the Ricci curvature is positive, one can argue that the minimal surface you produce is connected. And it's also possible to this is called the Frankel property. It's also possible to prove this in the high dimensional case. So this settles a conjecture of Yau in the positive curvature setting. So Yau conjecture that every three-dimensional compact Riemannian manifold must contain infinitely many minimal surfaces. So in the hyperbolic case, this follows from work of Kahn, Markovitch. Because they have produced incompressible surfaces with arbitrarily high genus, and then you can just use standard minimization methods to produce minimal surfaces, although they are not embedded because they come from these immersed objects. So I think there is also an approach by Rubinstein in one of his papers to prove that there are infinitely many minimal surfaces in hyperbolic metrics. So we get this infinitely many minimal surfaces. Of course, it's important now to study which properties they have. So, like, there are some recent results on estimates of the volume of such guys. It's the work of Sabu Ho, also Glean, Addy, and Leo Komovich. Very recent preprints on the archive on the behavior of the volumes of these surfaces. And maybe at this point I'll finish with mentioning just a couple of open questions. I said in the beginning of my talk that there's a lot that is known, as you can see from this talk, but also there are some important missing ingredients. The major one is the index bound. Right? This is open. So inspired by finite dimensional Moore's theory, one should expect that if you produce a critical point by performing min max over k parameters, you should expect that the index of this critical point should be bounded above by k, by the number of parameters. So this is an open question. So this is open even in the case of one parameters. This has been proposed by Pitts and Rubinstein. So generically maybe one should expect that the index is equal to k. So that's an important missing piece here. So we strongly believe that one could prove that the sum, you know, in this theory you can have several connected components. So one could prove potentially that the sum of the indices of these components is bounded above by k. But whether one can take into account the multiplicities in this definition of the index is not clear at this moment. So in the one parameter case, I should also mention that Shin Zhou has done this in the positive Ricci coverage case. And finally, you know, our interest now is that we have produced this minimal hypersurfaces, but the argument is indirect, as you'll see. The argument is by contradiction. So we'd like to have a more precise statement about the surface. So the ideal theorem would be something that would hold maybe for generic metrics, but with that would give you a list of minimal surfaces with some properties. So our conjecture is that say for a generic metric, say a bumpy metric of positive Ricci curvature in Sn plus 1, there should be a list of minimal of embedded minimal hypersurfaces, say sigma k, such that such that the index of sigma k is equal to k. Their multiplicity, as achieved by the Mimax theory, should be one. Their areas will go to infinity, and we expect that the first Betti number of these guys should grow linearly with the number of parameters. So this is the kind of statement that we'd like to have. So maybe I'll finish here. Thank you.
Are there any questions?
Is there a way to go from inverse to embedded?
Well, I think that it's not known, right, whether there is an embedded, whether you can make those embedded, right? So this is a question for the hyperbolic geometers, I guess. So, yeah, I don't think. So this is definitely like they'll be immersed by this method.
Anyone else? Actually, I had a question. On the link problem,
yes.
When you get equality, is there any statement about that it has to be some standard link?
Right, yeah, there is. Yeah. So I didn't mention that. So if the energy is equal to 2 pi squared, then the link must be conformally equivalent to the standard Hopf link. That's the link cosine of S sine of S 0, 0, and then 0, 0, cosine of T, sine of T, right, in S3. So it must be obtained. It must be like a Möbius image of that guy.
Anybody else? Okay, well, thank Fernando again.
Thank you.